So I am very, very pleased to have with us today in our department Dr. Phil Martin. Emeritus, right? Is that from UC Davis recently? Emeritus. And Phil got his PhD from UW-Madison and landed at UC Davis shortly thereafter in 1976. And then after that, in 1978, he went to the Brookings Institution. And this is where this entire journey begins. So Phil is, I would say, the foremost expert on labor migration, particularly in the United States, ag labor migration. And it started at the Brookings Institute when he was asked to look at labor migration in Europe. And that started this entire journey. In 1979, he was tapped by the Carter administration to be on the Select Committee for Immigration and Refugee Policies. And his work on this commission led to the 1986 Immigration Reform and Control Act, or IRCA. Now, it's worth noting that at the time of IRCA, there were an estimated 3.5 million undocumented workers in this country, and now that number is 11 million. Phil's work is, I was a graduate student, and so Phil's office was right there when I'd wander by the offices, and I didn't get to take any classes with you, but I did come to you for career advice at one point before graduating. And that's because I truly admire the kind of economics detective work that Phil does. He does work that I think makes a real impact on policy. Some evidence of this is he's given congressional testimony on numerous occasions on immigration and migration and undocumented workers in this country. So without further ado, we are very pleased to have you here. And please join me in welcoming Phil.
Thank you, Yoko, and I want to thank all of you for being here. So the main part of the story that Yoko did mention is that at the Brookings Institution in 1977, an economist got paid $15,000 a year, if I remember correctly. And when somebody offers you $15,000 to write about guest worker programs and you're 26 or 27 years old, you jump at the chance to double your salary in 6 months or so. And the takeaway point is that I still distinctly remember the meeting. So at the time, Europe had a lot of guest workers, a lot of Turks, Greeks, and stuff had moved to Europe. I had been a Fulbright Fellow, and my German wasn't that good. I had a lot of trouble renting an apartment because they weren't renting to foreigners when I was there in 1974. It was difficult. And what they really meant was they weren't renting to foreigners who did not look like me. They were renting to foreigners who looked like me. And it took me a while to get over the hump and get in and get an interview, and I got an apartment to live. And then I thought, well, why is this? And the answer, of course, was that there had been a big anti-foreigner backlash. They had stopped recruitment in 1973. And so I wrote a little thing on the benefits and costs of guest worker programs. And I remember writing that the economic benefits were immediate. People come in, they go to work. They're pretty measurable. You know, you measure their wages and that. And they're pretty concentrated among the complementary workers and the employers. The costs tend to be deferred because they usually come with families. They're much more diffused because they're over a larger society. And they're really hard to measure. I mean, how do you measure people who don't like having the smells or the sounds of different cultures? And so I didn't really have a conclusion, but I distinctly remember had that $15,000 or whatever it was sticking out there. And the people who were, it was the Joint Economic Committee of the Congress, and they wanted to not have a guest worker program for the U.S. as a way to deal then with the illegal migration. And the big dinner was at Ted Kennedy's house, the late Ted Kennedy. There was a guy named Wayne Cornelius from San Diego, and he was at MIT at the time, and I was this assistant professor at Davis on leave in Washington. And I never forget him saying, well, some of the Turks may have settled, but the Mexicans are birds of passage, homing pigeons. They're sojourners, not settlers. There will never be Mexicans settling in the United States, right? So famous last words. Remember, in 1970, about 1.5% of the people born in Mexico lived in the U.S. Today, it's 10%. He was wrong. I'm not sure I was right, but you can One of the things to always remember is you can become famous in economics or agricultural economics without ever being right. And keep that in mind. It's always a humbling prospect, but it really, there's a lot of truth to that. So, a couple of things here, and then I'll walk through this, and I realize some of you have to go early, so feel free to go when you need to. The main punchline is the number of unauthorized foreign workers in the U.S. has leveled out at about 8 million. So over the last 8 years, it's leveled out. What does that mean? This is the change in average hourly earnings of hired farm workers. And the purple ones here are the change for all non-farm production workers. So if you look at, and this makes sense, if you have a bigger sample, then you get a steady march upward in the non-farm of 2% a year. So non-farm average hourly earnings are advancing at roughly 2% a year. If agriculture hires primarily newly arrived and unauthorized workers, and there aren't more of them, then you would expect wages to go up faster. So for what it's worth, the red is California. And because the sample is smaller, you'll see it bounces around. This is 2010, 2011 and stuff. But then starting in 2014, 15, 16, we're going up almost 6% a year. The green, the yellow is Florida, and the green is Kentucky. So you can see small sample, or Kentucky, Tennessee, whatever, they group Kentucky with a few other states. So Kentucky is still having the bouncing. Some years you're way up, some years you're way down. That's probably not real. It's probably just because it's a relatively small sample. But once you get 2 or 3 years in a row, then you can think that, yes, we're starting to measure an impact, a significant impact. And I think we're seeing that somewhat in California. What we are seeing in California is a lot of aging farm workers. So that's going to be the message coming through. There's really three messages here. And since I taught for many years, one of the issues I should say is I did formally retire, but I'm back on 20% time, and I don't know how it is in Kentucky. But to show you how overstaffed we are at the University of California, they every month compare the payroll with the people who park. Believe it or not, when you retire, you get a free parking pass. And so after that I came back, they withdrew my free parking pass. And so now I have to either bike to school or find a place to park. So even in retirement, they still have plenty of people to make sure that nobody gets a single benefit to which they're not entitled. The main three messages are hired farm workers do most of the work in some commodities, especially fruits, especially vegetables and melons, and nursery commodities. And that's primarily what California specializes in. Here in Kentucky, it's going to be a lot more tobacco. Those hired workers nationally are about 70% born in Mexico. That means 30% born in the United States. And most of the Mexicans are not authorized to work in the U.S., which is why half of all the hired workers in the U.S. are not authorized to work. They are settling with families, and they're aging. And so the question is, what are farmers doing in response? And I call it the four S's is what they're doing. The first thing they're trying to do is to satisfy their current workers. Because if new people aren't coming in, and if people turn over, then you've got to try to keep the ones you have. How are they doing it? They're mostly using bonuses. So get 10% of what you earned if you stick through the season. Most farmers think the supply of labor in the U.S. is inelastic. That means there's not going to be any more at higher wages. So what they don't want to do is take their wage structure from $10 to $14. Because you got to pay that every year. Once you raise somebody's wage, it's hard to cut it. It's much easier and cleaner to give people a bonus. And that's the big thing that's coming. 10% bonuses, 20%. They're also trying to stretch the workers. What means increase their productivity? How do you increase their productivity? Well, fruits and vegetables, most of them are 90% water. And you're carrying things all the time. So how do you cut down on the carrying? You put a conveyor belt out in the field. You put a hydraulic platform so there's not ladders. So trying to make the work easier, more attractive to older workers, women. Substitution is the story of agriculture, labor-saving mechanization. There's a lot of that. Also, there's some switching of crops, get rid of raisin grapes, grow nuts. And then finally, there's supplement. The young people coming to the farm workforce are primarily born in other countries and they're coming in as legal guest workers under something called the H-2A program. The issue now is nobody knows what is the best strategy. So many farmers are doing all four simultaneously. So there's two or three slides here and then some pictures of how this all works out. Whenever you try to think about, so I'm from California and I've got a few slides in here on Kentucky, but a lot of the references, California accounts for about a third of all farm workers in the U.S. So we're about 1/8 of all the people, about 12% of the people, about 12% of the agriculture, but a third of the farm labor. And what makes California different is we have very high farm sales. California's been the number one farm state since 1950, not because we have the most acres of things, but because we grow high value crops. An acre is roughly a football field. An acre of strawberries is $60,000 gross revenue, $60,000, right? You go to Nebraska wheat, it's $600 or $800. So these are high value crops. And California is, even though it's the number one dairy state, it's primarily a crop state. So most of what's produced are crops, and then of the crops, I mean, they grow a lot of corn and alfalfa and stuff, but almost 90% are these fruits and vegetables and horticultural specialties, nursery flowers. And in that agriculture, labor is about 30% of production costs. So you're growing crops that have a high labor component, and then the demand is seasonal. And Kentucky is even more seasonal than California. So what that means is if you take a monthly snapshot, add it up, divide by 12, the average in California is a little over 400,000 people. But the total number of people who work on farms is almost double that, about 800,000, because of course there's a seasonal peak. And the question is, how do you get people to be there when you want them, but you don't take responsibility for them in the off season? That's an old problem that hasn't really ever been resolved. So that's the California three S's, and then the three C's. Just like Kentucky must be the same way, that there's a lot of farmers, but most farmers don't count. Kentucky, I think, has 75,000 or something farmers, and probably 50,000 sell under $10,000 worth a year. So it's really concentration in agriculture, and if you concentrate production, you also concentrate employment. So in the Census of Agriculture, 566,000 U.S. farms say they hire workers. Right? When it really gets down to who hires workers, it's under 10,000. Now, you don't hire them all, but they hire California, 900 hire 2/3 of the total. So we usually think of agriculture as a whole lot of small production units, and that's correct. But most of the production, most of the employment is on a relative handful of big farms. And in many parts of the United States, especially Florida, California, farmers don't hire workers directly. Instead, workers are brought to farms by non-farm employers. They're called, in the way in our North American industry classification system, they're called crop support services. The number one crop support service is a farm labor contractor, and they're about 2/3 of the total. Now, what happens is, I'm a farmer. I'm not a labor specialist. So in theory, if we have contractors to line up a series of jobs for seasonal workers and define workers for me, the farmer who only needs them seasonally, that should be win-win. Any of you looking for dissertation topics, Don Filmini tried to do this at Colorado State, look into why it is that what should be a win-win, if you have intermediaries specializing in finding workers and intermediaries specializing in assuring farmers that workers will be there, what in theory should be great, in practice turns out not to be great. Why is that? There's a lot of reasons with incentives. And then, so we have concentration contractors, and then, of course, conflict. And there's, you know, there are a lot of different labor markets, two basic kinds. There's exit labor markets and voice labor markets. Agriculture is an exit labor market. McDonald's, fast food's an exit. If you don't like your job, you leave. You don't like your supervisor, you go. The peaches look the same on every farm. The tobacco looks the same. So you go to where your friends are, where the supervisor is better. And that means if you have an exit labor market, who gets out first? The best workers. So what's left? The workers who can't get out. So you typically have The only people who make a career at McDonald's, I shouldn't say this because I don't know McDonald's, but many in general, the only people who make careers in agriculture are those who can't get non-farm jobs. Otherwise, they would get out. And that means you can't have a good union because the best people get out. And one of the things you should know about farm worker unions is they don't have locals. All decisions at the UFW are made in La Paz, right? Nobody ever gains leadership experience because the good people get out. There's no way to rise up. And of course, employers then think, how do I replace workers rather than how do I keep workers? So the big thing to notice, and this is just California, and then we'll get out of California here in a second, is that the yellow line are the workers who are hired directly on an average annual basis by farmers in California crops. The green are those brought to farms by non-farm employers. So since 2005, more people have been brought to farms by non-farm employers. The green and yellow are the third quarter, and the annual is the red and the blue. The punchline is, when you see a bunch of workers in the field, they're probably not employed by the farmer. They're employed by a non-farm contractor. And who are the contractors? Well, there's 3,000 of them in the United States, about half in California. Florida has a mix. And the main thing is, what is their real function? So the farm labor market actually has lots of regulations. It's almost, we usually say that the number one difficult labor market to operate honestly is hiring child actors and actresses in Hollywood. It is impossible to follow the rules. There's rules about their schooling, there's rules about their hours of work. So the labor commissioner says, I can go into any lot that they're shooting a movie with kids and there's going to be a violation. The number two is the farm labor market, because there's lots of rules, and somebody, if you walk into any farm, there's probably violating one of those rules. The labor contractors, when you do inspections, 90% of them have, 95% have some kind of violation. The question is, what's their role? Why is their role going up? Well, most of them are Hispanic. Most of them used to be farm workers. And they are risk absorbers. They're absorbing the risk in case of a violation. That's what their real critical economic function is. They absorb the liability. And where do they work? Remember, there's many wage systems, but there's two fundamental ones in agriculture. You can be paid hourly wages, which those of you who work for the library here or in Ag Econ might get as student support, might get hourly wages, or you can be paid piece rate wages with the guarantee that you'll get at least the minimum. Well, the normal rule of thumb is that if it's easy to control workers, if it's easy to manage workers, if you can easily see them, you pay hourly wages. So if you see a crew of people hoeing weeds in a field, they're often paid hourly wages because you can put a working supervisor and he or she sets the pace of work. But if the people are picking peaches or pears or apples and trees, it's really hard to control them. So in order to get them to work fast without supervision, you give them piece rate wages. And a very common job that labor contractors perform is bringing a crew to harvest crops for piece rates. Why? Because it's difficult to do supervision. The number one ag employer in North America is strawberries in California. The rule of thumb is it takes between 1.5 and 2 workers an acre. We've got 40,000 acres of strawberries, that's 60,000 plus workers. And it is a job that typically does pay piece rate, even though the strawberry plants are small, because the theory is you want people, so piece rate workers always earn more than the minimum. If they don't, they don't have any incentive to work fast. So the minimum wage in California right now is $10.50 an hour. If you're working piece rate in strawberries, you're averaging $12 an hour. It's got to be more than the minimum or there's no incentive. Vegetables hire both direct hire and sometimes with labor contractors. So the asparagus industry, green asparagus at least, has largely left the U.S., but basically there are some companies that do both direct hire and get workers through contractors. And then we've gone crop support, fruits, vegetables, and then if you go to nursery, moving plants, and dairy, that's actually 95% of the wages that are paid in this country, right? We have a lot of grain farms in the Midwest. They don't hire many people. We have a lot of beef farms. They don't hire many people. A lot of poultry farms. If you really look at it, we have 15 NAICS codes and five of them account for most of ag employment and wages. So who are the people then that are getting all these employment wages? Well, they're mostly men born in Mexico. I mean, that's the bottom line. And most of them are not authorized to be here. There's something called the National Agricultural Worker Survey. The problem, it's a national survey, it's not good for regions, but it's got a lot of data, and there have been really a lot of dissertations now done because it's publicly available data. They interview 3,000 workers a year, cost them $5 million a year. It's the only U.S. government survey that actually determines your legal status. They pay people $20, and when they get to the very end, then they say, ha, between you and this $20 bill is we've got to deal with this difficult question of are you legal or not, et cetera. Now, who knows if they get the correct answers, but that's the story. So the NAS, this national, defines a newcomer to the farm workforce as somebody who's been in the U.S. at least less than a year. So remember, they only interview farm workers at work. So you have to be working for wages in agriculture. And at the peak in 2000, about 1 out of 5 workers was a newcomer. Now it's 2%. So illegal migration to agriculture has almost stopped. And a result of that, the average age of U.S. farm workers is going up. It used to be farm workers averaged 25 years old or 26 years old. Now they average 38 years old. And the median age of all U.S. workers is 42. So farm workers are getting almost as old as the median worker. A lot of them are unauthorized. The average earnings across the U.S. are a little over $10. And workers are working more weeks. This is all U.S. data. They're doing 35 weeks of farm work, which is really higher than it's ever been before. Most don't find non-farm jobs, only about 1 out of 5. But I think the takeaway point is farm work is pretty much like non-farm work for most people. You don't live on the farm where you work. You usually carpool. And at the end of your work, you go back home, and you usually have a family with you. And most have only one farm employer in the course of a year. So this main story of the hired farm workforce is it's aging and settling. And that's bringing new challenges for agriculture. Because it used to be when people approached 40, they got out, and new 20-year-olds came in. That's not happening because they're not coming in, at least illegally. If you look at any survey from the NAS, all the stuff about youth, migration, etc., all peaked about 2000. And since then, we're getting this aging, settled, but still foreign-born, low-educated workforce. And the real big policy question is, farm work has always been a job, not a career. McDonald's is a job, it's not a career, for most people. And the reason for that is that if you look at data, the best way to help a farm worker is get them out of agriculture. Because on average, anybody who used to work in agriculture and gets out as a hired worker, not as a farmer, has higher earnings. So we spend $1 billion a year helping farm workers and their family, the federal government does. And they've done a pretty good job of convincing farm workers that their children should not do farm work. So children educated in the U.S. don't follow their parents into the fields, by and large, a few do. And what that means is the future farm workers who are going to work with their hands, they're growing up somewhere outside the United States. And the policy question is, how many barriers do you put between farmers here and workers somewhere outside the U.S.? I mean, that's really the fundamental issue. We've structured a system in which children don't follow their parents into the fields. And so the big policy question is, exactly how are you going to get the future farm workers? And the government basically is going to control. Let me just say one more thing before we get into how the farmers are adjusting. California's had an interesting experiment. We've raised our minimum wage 50% in the course of 6 years, right? So our minimum wage is now $10.50. It's going to go to $15 in 2022. That's a 50% wage increase in the course of 6 years. And most farmers pay the minimum wage or 50 cents more. If you're a big farmer growing a profitable crop, say lettuce, instead of paying 10, you'll pay 11, and that'll let you cream the best of the workforce. Now, the interesting part of that is, of course, that within a state, wages are not the same. And we have we're about 1 to 6. This is just average median incomes. So the San Joaquin Valley, which is where half of our agriculture is, headquartered around Fresno, in some of those cities, the average median incomes is under $20,000. Where in Los Altos over here, where eBay is located, it's over $100,000. So we are going to have the same statewide minimum wage. But the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to have a minimum wage which is 3/4 of the medium wage. Okay? Not even France has that. In France, the minimum wage is about 60% of the medium wage. So this is going to be historic. Somebody, there will be a lot of dissertations written on this. Is the higher minimum wage going to mean a whole lot of people now getting low wages get higher wages, or a whole lot of displacement of workers? So the biggest thing in some states, immigration's a big thing, but the other big thing, of course, is what about minimum wages? Because remember, over half of the states have minimum wages higher than the federal minimum. But we're back to our migration story. The red is Mexicans moving to the U.S., and the blue is people leaving the U.S. and moving to Mexico. And you see that in the late 90s, a whole lot of Mexicans moved from Mexico to the U.S., but in the most recent period, more people actually went to Mexico than came back. Now, I should tell you, we deport a little over 1,000 people a day, and they're about 80% Mexicans, and we put them on buses and send them back. Some of them return, but most do not. So when you talk about U.S. to Mexico, a lot of that is deportations. And what that means is, at least for Mexico, the number of illegal Mexicans has dropped by about 1 million in the last, say, 6 or 7 years. Now, agriculture is one of the first to feel the effects of fewer newcomers. Because if people are always exiting, either because of age or they found a non-farm job, then you have to get new people who come in. And then the question is, how do you respond when you have fewer people showing up? Well, this is now going through the four S's. You first try to satisfy them, you stretch them, substitute, supplement. And so what does that mean? Well, I already said, most farmers really believe raising wages won't get them more workers from the U.S. If you believe that, then you say, how can I give an attraction to keep people, to prevent them from leaving for non-farm jobs, and without raising wages permanently? So bonuses are the big thing. 10% bonus, 20% bonus. A typical farm worker is going to earn $15,000, let's say, in a long season, maybe 20. It's a lot cheaper to give a 10% bonus than it is to raise the wage structure, because once you raise it, it's hard to cut it. So lots of bonuses. Florida is actually subsidizing a thing, a farm labor supervisor. So a lot of supervisors, in first level supervision in the United States is bad, and first level supervision in agriculture is terrible, because the people who are supervisors sometimes are those who aren't good pickers, and they tend to favor their relatives and all this sort of stuff. And so Florida has done an experiment of trying to subsidize the training and give certificates and stuff to first level supervisors in agriculture. I don't know how far it's going to spread. California doesn't do this yet. But there is an effort to say, we've got to do a better job of satisfying workers, and one part of that is supervision. But the big effort in the short term is stretching. So it's mechanical wage. These conveyor belts you see in the field cost $100,000, $150,000, but they save steps. If we didn't have them, those workers would have to put the melons or the heads of lettuce in a bag, carry it to a spot, dump it, and then go back to work again. Sometimes they run, they fall, they get workers' comp claims. So this idea of slow-moving conveyor belts makes workers more productive. There is a technical issue about how you share the savings between the employer, who has to invest in the machine, and the worker, who now is going to get a lower piece rate if they're paying piece rate than he or she got before. But the idea is you make the work easier, and that makes workers more productive. There are many farmers who say, yes, I want to do my conveyor belts. There are many who say no. The conveyor belt through the field, especially if there's multiple picks, will damage something, so yields would be slightly lower. So agriculture, at least the farmers, are not united in whether it's good or bad. But for those who are worried about getting a labor force, mechanical aids are a big thing. As you put in conveyor belts, there's a whole lot of personnel issues that come up. So normally, when you pick apples in bags, you climb the ladder, fill the bag, 50 or 60 pounds, bring it down, dump it into a bin, and the piece rate for picking apples, depending on the variety, is, say, $18 to $30. But suppose we put people on a platform. So now you don't have ladders. You don't have that 60-pound bag hanging. I mean, smart pickers start at the top, and then the bag gets full as they go down. But nonetheless, you get a lot of falls as people miss a rung and stuff. So ladders are inherently dangerous. So a bunch of things you can do. Of course, one of the things you can do is to have dwarf trees, which will produce faster, and there's maybe no need for ladders. But the other thing you can do is these hydraulic platforms are fairly cheap, $100,000. And they eliminate the need for ladders and going up and down the steps. But the difficulty is that then, instead of me picking my bin, I'm now going to share with the other guys who share the platform. So there's a product there with the mechanical aid. You often go from an individual piece rate to a group piece rate. That can be very problematic. Those of you who study these things, it's going to be an interesting topic. The other thing you can do is, of course, you can mechanize. And this is the history of U.S. agriculture. In 1790, we had 95% of Americans living on farms. Today, it's under 2%. And so the story is really, as wages go up, you substitute. The main issue in agriculture is uniform ripening. In other words, you only can, with a machine, make one pass through the field. And so the olive oil industry is kind of new. And it was planted, the trees were planted with the idea of mechanical harvesting. The table olive industry is old. Olive trees live a long time. And it's not set up for mechanical harvesting. So what's happening? Olive oil is going like this. Table olives are going down. Because if they can't compete with table olives from lower cost countries, say Greece right now, for example. The famous story is the tomato harvester, because what they did was redevelop the plant so that more or less most tomatoes ripen uniformly, develop a machine to cut them and shake them off. In nurseries, there's a lot of movement of plants. This little robot called Harvey cost about $28,000. It works 24/7. The payback period is roughly 2 years. In fact, if you go to Carnegie Mellon, where a lot of these, where my daughter went to school, where a lot of these things are developed, their main thing is the Defense Department. And when you go to their labs, they'll tell you that if you're working for the Pentagon, the number one criteria is performance. That robot should save a soldier's life. If you're working on agriculture, it's not performance, it's cost. And it doesn't matter if you get all those apples off the tree, but boy, that machine can't cost very much. And it's got to be pretty durable. It's got to stand up to field conditions. And that's why whenever they try at a normal robotics lab to switch from what they normally do to agriculture, it's always a matter of how do you lower the cost and increase the reliability. There is a lot of mechanization going on. The raisin grape industry used to be the number one employer of farm workers in North America, because 6 weeks around Fresno, what you did was cut bunches of green grapes, you lay them on these paper trays, and they dry into raisins in the sun. And it's roughly a cent a pound, so 25 pounds in each tray, you get 25 cents. And there are ways to do grapes mechanically, to harvest grapes mechanically. You can cut the vines in which these grapes grow, and then they dry into raisins while they're still on the vine. The difficulty is you've got to invest up front to do that. You've got to have strong guy wires, you've got to buy that machine, and you have to spend money up front to save labor costs down the road. The problem with raisins and many other commodities is we're not cost competitive. Turkey this year will overtake the U.S. as the number one producer of raisins, and they can produce them and get them to New York cheaper than we can produce them. China is also coming up. So, you know, the joke is always, if you were planting raisin grapes, would you plant them for machines? The answer is, of course. But why would anybody be stupid enough to plant raisin grapes? Because it's not a very profitable commodity. they're tearing out raisins and putting in almonds. So mechanization works best in a fast-growing commodity, like olive oil. That's where it's all new plantings, all planted for that. There's a lot of effort to deal with iceberg lettuce. The iceberg lettuce is the most valuable green vegetable, despite the fact that people are switching to the romaines and stuff. And so the main issue with iceberg lettuce is the uniform ripening. They get about 75% of the yield in the first pass. And what their real efforts are trying to get uniform ripening. So once you get 90% of those heads ready in the first pass, then you could mow them off. And as soon as you mow them off, you could put electronic eyes and stuff to get out the immature heads. Hard to tell exactly what's going to happen, but there's a lot of money going into ag tech. But it's not just into mechanization. There's also H2A workers. So H2A is the name of the guest worker program that allows any farmer who anticipates a shortage of workers to request from the government certification to hire farm workers. You can recruit those farm workers in 60-some countries, but most of them come from Mexico. And the main story is that since that slowdown in Mexico-U.S. migration, the number of jobs certified to be filled by migrant workers has more than doubled. It was 75,000 in 2007. It's now 165,000 last year. Kentucky's right at about 7,000 H-2A jobs. So the big story is it's not that Kentucky has gone down. You've always been at 5,000 or 6,000 jobs. It's that other states have gone up. And the big story is the growth in Washington and California. Both of them, remember, California has roughly 400,000 farm jobs, annual average, 800,000 farm workers. In California, it's tripled, and in Washington, it's quadrupled, the state of Washington. Florida is still counts for the most, then North Carolina, then Georgia, but the potential for growth is fastest in those West Coast states. And the issue, there are a couple of issues with H-2A. In order to be certified to hire H-2A guest workers who tend to be young, much younger, their average age about 25, is you have to do three things. You have to try to find U.S. workers and fail. You have to provide free housing. You have to pay a super minimum wage called an adverse effect wage rate. Now, the brown are the lowest, these adverse effect wage rates, and a little under $11 an hour, for example, in Kentucky. And you'll notice the yellow are the highest. The reason for the yellow in the Midwest here is that this is all Canadian combine crews. They come down to Canada, they start in whatever that is, Kansas or one of those in Nebraska, and they move up. And so there are not that many farm workers there. So even though that wage is super high, it applies to relatively few people. But you'll notice that the H-2A program is expanding, but a lot of farmers say, but look, I don't want to pay that super high wage because they have to pay it to the farm workers and also to any U.S. workers that they have. Let me just end with a few things about where we are in immigration reform in Washington. So Mr. Trump campaigned on seven issues, two of which dealt with immigration. Build a wall, deport the unauthorized foreigners. Mrs. Clinton had 38 issues, one of which was about immigration. So remember the story here. I'm not in this administration, but I do talk to some of the career people. What happened is that Trump started out attacking Mexico and Mexicans, saying they bring drugs and all that sort of thing. His big speech on immigration was August 31st last year. He went to Mexico that day, then he went to Phoenix, and he made the speech in which people thought he would back off his promises on the wall and deporting. He did not. He doubled down on it. And that's why in January of this year, they canceled a meeting. So in his first week, Mr. Trump issued three executive orders dealing with migration. And the actual implementing plans were laid out in memos starting on February 20th. The first of those memos dealt with how they're going to build a wall on the Mexico-U.S. border. Nobody knows exactly what it'll cost. The number in the document says $21 billion. And you can see the wall, there's about 2,000 miles of border, and about 750 miles, about a third, is now fenced, or being fenced, as you can see they're building. And it's a reasonably substantial fence, if you haven't been down there. This man is in Mexico, and you can see it's more than twice or so his height. If you look really carefully at the top, you'll notice it leans back into Mexico, so that when he gets there, he's going to have a little trouble. But what you don't see are the ropes and the blankets that people are going to throw to him, so that when he gets to the top, he can actually get over. But it's a significant sort of barrier. And what the memo calls for is adding, we have 21,000 Border Patrol agents now. We're going to add 5,000. Cost $200,000 per person per year. Not that they get that much, but they get a lot of overtime, and they have a lot of benefits. So the first thing that we're going to do is, if we follow through on the plan, is remember there are only 2% newcomers in agriculture. And if this proceeds as planned, we'll probably be down to 1% or half of 1%. It will get tougher and more expensive to get across the wall. The second thing that the memos do is deport the unauthorized from within the U.S., Interior Enforcement. And here's the story. The real big question is, will the U.S. resume workplace raids? So there were no workplace raids really under Obama. There were under George W. Bush. Workplace raids is you go in, like to surround a meatpacking plant or a poultry processing plant, take a lot of buses, and at Swift and Company, when they did it, they arrested about 1 out of 5 workers. Swift had to shut down until it could hire replacement workers. So the theory is we're going to double the number of these so-called ICE, Immigrations and Customs Enforcement agents, from 10,000 to 20,000. Now, remember, it takes time for the government to screen and hire people and stuff, but the idea is that the number of deportations, now running 1,000 a day, could be stepped up to a higher number. And the effect is likely to vary by state. The state with the highest share of one, these are Pew numbers, Pew in Washington, in Nevada, about 1 out of 10 workers is thought to be unauthorized, primarily because of the big construction and hospitality industries, not agriculture. In California, it's a little less. Texas is a little less. Kentucky, you're under 2%, according to Pew, so relatively few. This is not immigrant workers. This is unauthorized workers. And if you look at where, what now, and now we're switching from unauthorized to all foreign born workers. If you look at the number one job held by foreign born workers by state, in 5 states, it's agriculture. That's the West Coast, Idaho, and I think New Mexico. In 8 states, it's housekeepers. So this is occupation, the number one occupation of people born in another country, regardless of their legal status. And it's janitors. So it's basically lower skilled occupations where we have the most immigrants. And so that's why we tend to associate immigrants generally, and unauthorized immigrants in particular, with a couple of sectors. Construction, we also do services, but in other words, about 1 million unauthorized workers work in agriculture. There's 8 million unauthorized workers. There's probably 2 million in hotels and restaurants. The share of unauthorized in agriculture is higher than anywhere else. But the number of unauthorized is bigger in hotels and restaurants simply because there are so many more people employed in hotels and restaurants. And then, of course, agriculture looms large. And that was my hope. I didn't realize I had a slide on it. The share of unauthorized is higher in agriculture, but not the number of unauthorized. Most unauthorized people don't work in agriculture. 7 million out of 8 million work in the non-farm sector, construction, hospitality, and stuff. We don't know what's going to happen. Well, this is the first president since, Thomas Jefferson or something, who owns a winery. He actually uses H-2A workers on his winery near Charlottesville. The theory is that, according to the wine people in California, Mr. Trump drinks no alcohol, but they say we know what kind of wine will be served at the White House now. But the fact that Mr. Trump uses H-2A workers leads a lot of farmers in California to think that he's going to wind up relaxing the rules on the H-2A program. So what's next? We're getting to the end here. Well, we're going to have more enforcement. There's no two ways about that. There's going to be more fencing. There's going to be more agents on the border. What we don't yet know is how many more deportations there are going to be from the United States, from within the U.S. And what we really don't know is, will we repeat what we did in the 1950s? So in the mid-1950s, we deported 1 million people in a year. And how did we get, we didn't deport them all, many left on their own. How did we get so many people to leave on their own? If you get picked up at work you actually don't get to go home, usually, and get your belongings. You normally get detained and then sent out, especially if you're from Mexico. And that's what we did in the mid-1950s. So what happens? If you think you're going to get picked up anyway, you're ahead of the game if you, what they call self-deport. If you say, I'm going to leave on my own, because at least that way I can take my belongings and say goodbye to people and all that sort of thing, rather than being picked up at work, not being allowed, etc. So I don't know whether we're going to get to that point of enforcement or not, but we have a precedent for it. The second thing is that there is an internet program called E-Verify. When you get hired, you fill out an I-9 form and all that sort of stuff. If the employer sends it into the government, they can tell right away if you're legal or not legal. And there's a lot of, it's passed the House a few times to require all employers to submit data on new hires. Now the reason that's important is that if it comes back suspicious, which it does about 1% of the time, then I'm supposed to tell you, I'm the employer telling you, it looks suspicious, and you have 1 week to clear it up. And if you don't, I'm supposed to fire you. If I don't fire you, then I'm in the computer on record as knowing that I knowingly hired an unauthorized worker. If this were to be enacted, a seasonal industry like agriculture would be hit pretty hard because they rehire people all the time. And that's why people say that E-Verify should be coupled with easy guest workers. That's the big question is, will that happen? On policies, well, we can skip the policy stuff. But the summary of everything is, for agriculture anyway, is it's important to remember that hired farm worker employment is going up. A lot of reasons. Because the labor-intensive commodities, actually the demand is increasing for fresh produce. It's also the fewer and larger story. Even in tobacco and traditional crops, if it's fewer and larger, there's going to be more hired workers. But that workforce, that hired workforce is aging. It's aging and settling. It's looking like the average American worker, as opposed to being a young, migrant, flexible workforce. And farmers are responding to it right now with those four S's of satisfy and stretch and substitute and supplement. And no one knows which of the four is the correct strategy. In other words, you know, we have big farmers in California putting lots of money into housing on their farms to hire H2A guest workers. Is that the right strategy? Nobody really knows. If you want to read more, just Google rural migration news. There's a lot of stuff there. And it covers especially what's happening on the agricultural guest worker programs. And it's mostly law students who do stuff, and so sometimes they're really, you know, most things in farm labor are not new. Sometimes they're shocked about things, but there's a lot of information. And then this afternoon, we're going to talk just mostly about non-farm. We'll talk a little bit about agriculture because Yoko asked, but it'll be more. I used to work a lot. My PhD was actually in economics, but I guess I got a master's in agricultural economics. So I used to work a lot more on just general economics. And so this will be more on the general, but we'll talk a little bit about agriculture and doing it, but it's more on how migration generally works in the non-farm economy. That's this afternoon. Okay, with that, I can stop, and there should be a few minutes for Q&A if there are any.
A simple starting question is, is there a reason why you use non-authorized as opposed to undocumented?
That's the official term, sorry. There's a lot of terms. You can call people illegal, which is what we did back when I worked on this stuff in the late 70s. Then along came undocumented, but that's actually a misnomer, because if you've ever interviewed undocumented workers, they have plenty of documents. In fact, the typical way to get hired in California is to go to a flea market, get a driver's license, and an I-551, the immigrant visa, and make 20 copies, because you just hand the copy when you get hired. And that's still what I think most advocates use, but the government term is unauthorized. That's the reason.
So if you took first stage processing, poultry processing plants, hog processing plants, beef kill plants, and added those in, how much more does that add?
I got involved in after the Swift and Company raids in December of 2006. At that time, meat and poultry processing together had about 400,000 production workers in the U.S. So remember, those were year-round jobs by and large, not seasonal. And the Hispanic share was only about half. So I mean, there was a lot of, and especially there were a lot of women, a lot of black women in poultry processing. There's a lot of poultry processing, I forget where, Alabama maybe or something.
There's a lot of poultry processing in Kentucky. The sort of classic example is we put a poultry processing plant in south central Kentucky, which was a high unemployment state or county, 10 years ago, and the logic was, even though the birds were growing a long way away because that would create local jobs, the local people lasted about 3 months.
Well,
and then it was all...
I've been through a lot of beef and pork and poultry processing plants in my life, and what I've been told, I don't know whether this is correct or not, but what I've been told is the line speeds today are far faster than they used to be. And the only commodity I really studied this, you know, in a great deal of depth was cutting sugarcane in Florida, hand-cutting sugarcane in Florida. So if you, in Florida, you had to cut a ton and a half of sugarcane an hour to keep your job. That was all H-2A guest workers from Jamaica, right? If you go down to the Caribbean, the average productivity is about one half of a ton per hour. So what were they doing? They were paying, at that time, a wage of roughly 1.5 times the minimum wage. And they were selecting people who were capable of achieving that productivity. I couldn't do it. Maybe you could, but I could. And that's the same when you watch people pick apples or cut lettuce. You're bent over doing it. There are people who can achieve that level of productivity. But on almost any commodity, we don't really have much historical data on what average productivity rates were. But whether it's picking apples or whatever, the productivity of workers today is far greater than it was 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. And the workforce, of course, is much more homogeneous today than it was, because it's now mostly Mexican-born men, whereas 20, 30, 40 years ago, it was some teenagers, some housewives, you know, some older workers. So we're in a situation in which we fine-tuned a hand labor harvesting system that depended on a constant influx of new 20 to 25-year-olds who would stay a decade or two. And now we're adapting to where, you know, the new people aren't coming in. You're trying to hang on to the older people who haven't gotten out yet. I don't know how we'll do it. It's going to be, if you extend it to the poultry processing stuff, I don't know, the last poultry processing plant I went through, the whole discussion was, they complained that they had to spend so much money for environmental compliance, they could not spend money on mechanizing the disassembly operation. And so I don't know what the truth is, but I have been told that, especially in poultry processing, more money is going into complying with environmental laws than labor-saving automation.
Well, one of the limiting things on poultry is that every fast food restaurant has the bird cut up a different way.
Ah, so they have to specialize it. But if the price went up enough, I'm sure that the fast food restaurants could get some uniformity there. What else?
Being the contractor for the labor, their farm labor, I was wondering, so the contractors, are they hiring people from various locations and then ship them to a specific farm? Or they kind of go to the, they made a deal with a big farm in California and then started to look for laborers for them locally?
Most labor markets are local. So if I am providing, you know, if I'm a contractor providing workers to farmers in this county, mm-hmm. I'm typically going to be in this county, I'm going to recruit workers from this county. So most labor markets are local. And what happens in the labor contracting that makes it difficult is that the farmer and the contractor normally agree on a wage rate. It's either a piece rate or an hourly wage. So the farmer is going to pay $10 an hour to get the work done. Then what's negotiated is the commission that the contractor will get over and above the wage. And with that commission, he or she has to cover Social Security tax, unemployment tax, workers' comp, all the toilets in the fields, the I-9s and stuff. and make a profit. And that's where you see the issue, because I was on a commission that went around, an interesting exercise, we went around the U.S. holding hearings for three or four days in, I don't know, 20 locations around the U.S. And I would always ask people, since he put me on the commission, what's the overhead rate? Now, if you add it up, if there's any ladders, that's going to be a 15-18% workers' comp rate right there. So, add it up, they got to have a 30% commission. Well, sometimes it'd be 25%. You would ask people testifying, how do they make money? Well, they make a joke, they make it up on volume. Well, they're cheating. There's just no two ways about it. They're cheating the government. A lot of people have two sets of books, so they're not forwarding the payroll taxes. If the workers are illegal, they're not going to apply for benefits anyway. And so you know that the system is competitive enough between the various contractors that they bid down. So I'm sure there are some contractors who make a lot of money, but in general, it's not a high margin. It's an easy entry business, and it tends not to be a high margin business. And I don't know how you break that conundrum.
So these contractors are not facilitating the H-2A visas?
Some of them do. Yeah, that's one of the ironies is they're allowed to bring in H-2As.
Right, because as I understand it, or at least locally, a lot of the labor contractors are facilitating.
Yeah, in California, it's almost all labor contractors. Now, the issue you get with this is that, and I don't know if they operated here, there was a company called Global Horizons. It was an Israeli company, got kicked out of Israel. They went to Beverly Hills, and sort of anytime you have a labor contract in Beverly Hills, you should probably raise it. They brought in ties. And their business model, and they did a lot of work in Washington, they eventually got put out of business, but their business model was to charge the workers up front. They were charging the Thai workers $10,000 up front for the jobs. Our laws say you shouldn't. So that means they didn't care. Turns out Thailand doesn't grow a lot of apples, and these guys didn't know how to pick apples, so it wasn't. But their business model depended on collecting the money up front from the workers. So it didn't really matter what happened once the workers got here. And, you know, these cases come up. We just had a case in after Katrina with Mississippi, with Indian guys coming over on H-2B visas. You're going to see a lot of scandals coming up because the H-2A program will expand. And the farmer may actually be innocent on it. Some are, some aren't. Because there were kickbacks in some cases with Global Horizons. They collect $10,000 from the worker, they kick back $2,000 to the farmer of that. But you know, you can have a farm employer who says, you know, be strictly honest. Our laws say you can't charge the workers anything for the jobs. But it's really hard to police. I mean, I do a lot of work in Bangladesh. And all you gotta know is Bangladesh and Iowa are geographically the same size. Iowa has 3 million people. Bangladesh grows by 3 million people roughly every year. So when a Bangladeshi goes to Saudi or UAE, they're going to get $250 a month while they're there. So they're going to get $7,200 in 3 years. They're going to be in debt $2,500 as they leave. So they're going to work the whole first year just to pay off the recruitment debt. And that, unfortunately, is a very... I have a book coming out this summer on these merchants of labor who... It's mostly on the Middle East,
right?
Because there, the model is the worker pays. The low-skilled worker, because the high-skilled worker has paid for the education to be a nurse or a doctor, so they don't pay. The employer pays. But if it's a low-skilled worker, you haven't invested in the education, and you're going to pay because there's 10 of you wanting for each one of those jobs over there. And I don't know how we get our arms around that, because no matter what laws you make, it's a victimless crime. If I pay you to get a job and you give me a job, I mean, I'm not going to complain because I got what I wanted. I wanted a job at higher wages. You know, minimum wage in Bangladesh is about $50 a month, and over in Saudi I get $250, and my housing and food is covered. So they'll tell you, you know, for them it was a rational decision. But nonetheless, from a human rights point of view, if you arrive in debt, you're certainly not going to complain about the job. Because suppose, you know, you could complain, but then you get fired and you go back and you have that recruitment debt hanging over you.
I think this is two questions and then we'll close.
If you could briefly comment on what you've witnessed in ag labor markets in response to the drought, and if there's been kind of structural kind of shift towards certain areas, or you know, if there's more uncertainty in the labor space, if that's something that's
Okay, that one's fairly easy. We covered the drought enormously, and labor implications in rural migration news. But the main story is there was no impact on labor. I mean, think about it this way. We have 5 years of drought. As water got more expensive, the water available got shifted to the highest value use. What was it? Labor-intensive fruits and vegetables. So yes, there were 500,000 acres of land fallowed, but what was fallowed? Low-value cotton, which was shrinking anyway and which is automated, but not the vegetables. So the labor impact was far, far less. Now, Dick Hallett and some of his colleagues, they stretched and twisted the numbers because everybody wanted to find these big labor impacts. But the state of California official data was showing increasing ag employment through all the drought years. And I don't know what will happen going forward. I mean, it's hard. If you haven't seen, it's hard to sort of understand. But what they used to say is the average price of an acre foot of water in California is $10. But the variance is enormous, from roughly zero to well over $1,000. And so I have a student, 3,000 acres of almonds, and he actually is pushing out some almonds where there was not guaranteed water and the groundwater's gone. Whereas the guy next door to him, well, not literally next door, but close by, is got a different water district, and he's just dumping water on his pasture for cows. And there's no, water's heavy, there's no physical way to get, and he's roughly, I'm paying a dollar an acre foot, you know, it's all complicated. There's no physical way to get the water from that low value use to pastures to the higher value use on the almonds, because the system is all directed that it has to come through the canals. I mean, I haven't studied water, but the main takeaway is there was almost no impact. I mean, there was some, but minimal impact overall in the drought and labor. Even though a lot of money was spent, I mean, again, the joke was, the state of California passed an emergency bill to provide hundreds of million dollars to help displaced farmers. They couldn't find any. So what they got was Hispanics who were poor and in those areas and who may have done farm work in the past but were no longer active farm workers. If you look at their age structure, they're in their 50s, a lot of them. So there was money spent, but it was really hard to find.
Jessica,
the
last question.
Cool. So I guess I would perceive a lot of these labor market issues to be threats. I'm specifically interested in the dairy industry, so that's partly where my question is coming from. So what do you see as some of the technical hurdles to just wanting to mechanize and say, okay, I'm going to get robotics on my dairy instead of, and just avoid all of these labor issues? Of course, if there's a big incentive to switch to that, that would, you know, dictate we do that, but what do you see as some of the technical hurdles to being able to just mechanize and instead of depending on migrant labor?
So I gave a talk in January to the dairy guys in Florida. They meet in fancy hotels. And I think the takeaway from it all is Europe is way ahead of us in robotic milking systems mm-hmm. and stuff. As I understand it, it's not my area, but as I understand it, we don't like to do these rotary milking things, robotic rotary milking things. We have a different system. The capital cost up front is much higher, and our, at least California dairies, are too big. Some of these dairies have 25,000 cows. And so their argument is, what Europe has developed with freestanding milking parlors and stuff works okay for 50 or 100 cows, but doesn't work for 20,000 cows. In Wisconsin, which is actually surprised me, that's the California guys didn't express that much concern about labor. It was the Wisconsin guys, and as I understand it from talking to them, in Wisconsin you've had maybe more cows but fewer dairies, so it's fewer and larger. And many of them who before were not in the unemployment insurance system now are, so they're covered by new laws and stuff as they got bigger. And they're the ones who before maybe didn't have as big a herd, didn't hire as many people, are now hiring much more. So a lot of the pressure, it seemed to me, from the labor side was coming out of places where the dairy structure is changing toward fewer and larger, and they're getting away from family and into hired, whereas the people who have been hired all the time, like California or the Three Mile Canyon up in Oregon and stuff, you know, they've been used to it, and they don't express quite as much concern. I mean, the big lobbyists from the dairy guys, you know, they've been trying to get rid of that. Right now, the typical H2A cannot stay more than 10 months. There's a bit of an exception for sheep herders. So there's been a bill in Congress for 10 years to allow H2A workers to stay for 3 years. And if that happened, then the dairies could get into the industry. But the pressure to get that bill passed seemed to me to be coming more from the upper Midwest than it was coming from California. It's not that the California guys wouldn't like it, but that's where the pressure seemed to be the greatest.
Thank you. All right. Well, before we... I'd like to make two announcements. So as Dr. Martin mentioned, there is a talk at 4 o'clock today.